Good morning. You're watching Proactive London. Nick Britton from the AIC joins us because, Nick, something on everybody's mind is cost of living, energy prices. You can't go to any pub or supermarket in the country without somebody having an opinion and affecting everybody. So let's just do this piece by piece. Good to see you this morning. Thanks for your time.
Great to be here. Thanks for inviting me.
No, you're very welcome. Proactive, actually, one of our analysts recently did an article about maybe a way to beat inflation. Now, if we can beat inflation, that would be problem solved. But for people looking then for stocks and investments to protect against rises in price rises in portfolios, is that an option for people who are seriously trying to get around this cost of living crisis and to make wise choices?
Sure. Well, I suppose the first thing we should say is, you know, we're talking about the stock market investing. There are no guarantees. No. And that's the first thing we should say. But there are some things you could invest in that perhaps give you a better chance of beating inflation. And if we look at the world of investment trusts, I'd probably highlight three areas. One of them would be the investment trusts that have been very worried about inflation for a very long time. And we call them capital gearing, capital preservation investment trusts, the likes of capital gearing, rougher personal assets. And these investment trusts have been basically banging on about inflation for ages during the time when nobody was worried about it. And they've built their portfolios to protect against sort of bursts of high unexpected inflation as we're seeing at the moment. So if you think that actually we haven't seen the worst of inflation, and we saw a pretty worrying report last week, didn't we, from Citi that was talking about UK inflation perhaps peaking above 18%. If you think that's likely to happen, then you know these investment trusts are the ones perhaps who've built in the protection into their portfolios to be able to weather that kind of inflation. Other than that, you've got investment trusts investing in the UK market, and the UK market's actually done better out of this inflation than the US market or lots of other markets globally because of its concentration in things like commodities, oil, and banks. And so investment trusts investing in, you know, UK equities have been a relative safe haven, relative, not, you know, absolute, still seen some volatility. And the third thing I'd point to for sort of inflation protection would be investment trusts investing in some alternative assets. Now, these would include things like property, for example, and infrastructure, where they're investing in assets or contracts that have inflation protection almost contractually built in. So the tenant or government body, in the case of infrastructure, is contractually obliged to pay an income stream that rises in line with inflation. And that's got very obvious appeal at a time like this, although we should also be aware that some of those contracts actually have a cap as well on how much they're going to rise.
It's very interesting you say that, Nick, and certainly you say with protection built in, and there are no certainties, as we all know, but those groups that have been thinking about this for a long time, and of course we saw inflation hit a 40-year high back in July in the UK. I know, though, from looking around at recent reports as well, that some analysts, maybe coming out of Deutsche Bank, were saying they think inflation is not set to continue on its ascendancy, but to come down.
Mm. Well, of course, nobody really knows, do they? And that is the thing. If we did, it would all be easy. And the only thing is, people have been saying things like that, haven't they, for quite a long time, that actually this is the top now. And the Bank of England famously kept saying, well, it's going to peak at this level, this level, this level. And the level they say it's going to peak keeps going up. So perhaps wise to be a bit cautious. But of course, you know, it could surprise on the downside. And the thing to do is to have a diversified portfolio. You don't necessarily want everything in, you know, banks and mining stocks. A bit of diversification, recognizing the fact that some of the assets that have suffered most during this time of inflation are the ones that are going to bounce back most, of course, when inflation eventually does subside and come down. So, you know, diversification is always very important.
It is very much the question, how long is a piece of string, isn't it, when it comes to that kind of thing? Also, I noticed that the Atrato Group favoured green energy as another possible asset. But amid an environment of soaring energy prices, it says corporates are looking to buy power for less than it costs to source it directly from the grid. I mean, that maybe is a contrasting view, I know, because recently writing in the Mail on Sunday and the Telegraph, Kwasi Kwarteng, the Secretary of State for Business, was talking about reining in green profits as the energy cap is set to soar. So where do people who aren't overly au fait with this type of investment, where do they look to go for the right information? It's difficult to tell, isn't it?
Well, the report you mentioned of the government's plans to offer renewable energy generators a 15-year fixed price for energy is actually quite interesting, because at first glance, this doesn't look great for renewable energy generators. There's also been talk of a windfall tax, by the way, on renewable energy generators as well. It's a separate thing. But the sort of fixed price idea for energy may not be an entirely bad thing for the investment trust that invests in renewable energy, because at the moment their income is determined by two things. One of them is subsidies, which are sort of increasingly less important as time goes on, and the other is energy prices, basically gas prices. And so if you're dependent on gas prices, it's very good when they're going up, not so good when they're going down, so you have quite a lot of volatility. Now, a 50-year deal, potentially, that would fix prices, presumably inflation-linked, otherwise nobody would ever sign up for that if you're a generator, you know, would give you quite a lot of predictability over quite a long time horizon. And that is what investors in these kind of investment trusts are looking for. So it could actually be quite an interesting development where, yes, you'd sacrifice a little bit of the higher gains now, but over the long term, you sort of lock in an indexed price for your energy that would be more predictable over time.
Yeah, absolutely. And at the moment, you say there's no certainty, and it's even more difficult with a Conservative leadership contest still to run its course as to find out exactly what the government's position is going to be come early September regards energy prices and caps and the like. Let's move on then to the general outlook for the markets. The quarterly rebalance of the FTSE looks set to herald a handful of changes, all still to be determined, of course, by the closing positions at the end of the month. But one I know we're keeping an eye on, lining up to maybe take its place, is FNC, the world's oldest investment trust. What's your take on the news coming out of that market at the moment?
Yeah, absolutely. It's fascinating to see FNC maybe going back into the FTSE 100. It's been in the FTSE 100 before. As you say, it is the world's oldest investment trust, arguably the world's oldest collective investment fund. And I think almost certainly the world's oldest surviving investment fund. So, yes, it's a generalist portfolio spread across different markets across the world, mostly investing in quoted equity, a little bit in private equity, and a sort of, I suppose, flag bearer for the whole sector. And if it does go back into the FTSE 100, that would mean that there would be four investment trusts in the FTSE 100, which has never happened before, actually. So it would be quite a notable moment for our industry. More broadly speaking, on the outlook, of course, it is still very volatile and uncertain. We had, there's no sugarcoating. It's a pretty terrible first half of the year. The average investment trust was down 17%, and investment trusts do tend to do worse than other funds when the market goes down, because those discounts of the investment trust trade out, that they widen. Sometimes there's gearing involved as well. The summer saw a little bit of a bounce back. Now we're looking at sort of 12% down on the year. And discounts of investment trusts, that's the difference between their share price and the underlying assets in the investment trusts, are at around 10%, which is actually a wider level than they've been at for quite a while. And, generally speaking, although I'm certainly not calling the bottom of this market, but generally speaking, when you've bought investment trusts at a double-digit discount in the past, you've proceeded to do very well. For example, in the financial crisis, if you'd bought investment trusts, or the average investment trust, at the end of October 2008, when it was on a double-digit discount, you would then have trebled your money over the next 5 years. So historically, and again, no guarantees this is going to happen this way this time, but historically, buying investment trusts on wider discounts has worked out quite well for investors.
Of course, and everything is interlinked, from the news coming out from Eastern Europe, energy prices, inflation. There's something for everyone there, and I've no doubt you'll be keeping your finger very closely on that pulse, and we hope to catch up with you again. In the meantime, Nick Britton from the AIC, thanks for unpacking those details. Thank you very much.